Well, first on the hub, it started in Tunisia, then came Egypt, Yemen and Libya. The pro-reform protests there then sparked in Syria, the first taking of risks to challenge the Assad government's tight grip on power. The first street protests were occasional. Social media then emboldened many more people to join in, despite a deadly response from the security forces and the military. Well, the United Nations estimates 2,500 people have been killed right across Syria. The International Committee of the Red Cross has appealed in person for the Assad regime to respect human rights. Instead of rumour and word of mouth, what we know about the scale of protests in many of these locations like this has been confirmed by dramatic real-time mobile phone video. Here, for example, Hama. This video shows unrest on the 20th of September. School children in uniform chanting that even Syria's schools are not safe anymore. Here, a neighbourhood of Homs. Mass crowds gather in Bab Amro, chanting they will continue until the regime falls and Syria wants freedom. Well, during the last few months, the BBC and other news organisations have made repeated attempts to gain access to Syria. Finally, my colleague Lise Doucette has been granted a visa. She joins the hub live from the capital, Damascus. Lise.
Yes, and welcome to the Syrian capital, Damascus. We're at the studios of Syrian television, right in the heart of the city. And as you've been saying, there's been severe reporting restrictions here. Foreign journalists have found it very difficult to enter this country to report on the extraordinary developments that have unfolded here over the past 6 months. 6 months of protests on the streets of many of Syria's cities, 6 months of an extraordinary crackdown by Syrian security forces. Well, the government has long criticized the foreign media for telling only one side of the story. In a moment, we're going to speak to a senior advisor of President Bashar al-Assad. But first, let's look at the situation in Damascus. Like other uprisings across the Arab world, the focal point of protests hasn't been here in the capital. But it hasn't meant that Damascus is free of the kind of pressures and street politics that are unfolding elsewhere. We've been trying for months to take the road to Damascus.
We had to spend hours at the border getting in as they looked through every page of our passports, every bit of equipment. But so few journalists are getting in to tell this story.
The government complains nobody is telling their side. I've been coming to Syria for years. So what's changed after 6 months of protest and a brutal crackdown? You don't feel it here in the heart of the old city. Damascus hasn't lost its charm or bustle, but there are no tourists to enjoy it. Business is suffering. I didn't expect people to openly criticize the government, with our official minder, however amiable, at our side. One man who happily told us on camera there were no problems, later whispered to me he couldn't tell the truth. Plainclothes intelligence agents are everywhere. We start to see familiar faces. But there is clearly some genuine support for the president.
But you are talking very lie about Syria.
Well, I didn't lie, it's my first day here.
No, you are lying because everybody here, the population, 23 million persons from Syria, love Bashar al-Assad and support Bashar al-Assad.
These are what he calls lies, the videos sent by activists. The government insists these protesters are criminal gangs. Activists who did believe in dialogue no longer do. He tells me the government tried to force people off the streets with violence. It failed. This could be a moment of no return. But no one here can say when the end will come and what kind of Syria will emerge.
So that is the big question. What kind of Syria will emerge from this very deep crisis? We're joined here by Dr. Bouthaina Shaaban, who's the senior advisor in both politics and the media for President Bashar al-Assad. Thank you for joining us BBC News.
Thank you, Lise, for coming to Damascus.
Dr. Shaaban, we've talked on the telephone in interviews over the past 6 months. You always said to us, to the world, that reform was coming. But everyone, including the protesters on the street, say it hasn't translated into action. They don't believe the president anymore.
Well, I don't know what they mean by reforms if it hasn't come yet. I mean, for these 6 months, we have so many things that had been done that I wouldn't have dreamt for them to be done in 10 years. And I will count them in a minute. I mean, a new the emergency law has been lifted, a new electoral law has been issued, a new political party law has been issued.
But let's take one of those. The emergency law was lifted, was a very important announcement by the president.
That's right.
But then look at what is happening on the streets of Hama, on homes, even in the suburbs of Damascus, where the protesters, we've seen the videos showing the security forces opening fire on the protests. So whether or not emergency law has been lifted or not, the reality hasn't changed.
Well, the problem is that with these protesters, there are armed and violent people. And the problem is that Western press did not want to believe any of that. Today in Homs, two university professors had been assassinated. Yesterday, a very important doctor had been killed by armed people. Right from day one, we had protesters, but we had armed gangs who are killing and maiming people. Who killed 800 people of army and military and policemen?
Do you believe, Bouthaina Shaaban, that the majority of protesters are armed gangs?
No, not the majority, no. I didn't see that. I didn't say the majority, but there are, I mean, the peaceful protesters, it's fine, you know, and all.
Are they the majority? And they have, the president once said, they have legitimate grievances.
Of course, they have legitimate grievances. And if you think of all the laws that has been issued, and now the president is formulating a committee in order to review or rewrite the constitution. And then we will have parliamentary election in February. So what can you do? I mean, this is what has been asked. This is what the Syrian people want. Look, I feel that the issue now, really, is not the regime or not President Assad. The issue is for the country not to slide into sectarian war.
Well, this exactly is what people are saying. And what the issue for most people now is that the killings must stop. Take one of the most recent examples, which Amnesty International has called the most disturbing case in detention. 19-year-old Zainab Al-Hassani, the first woman to die in detention. Her parents found, by mistake, her decapitated body in the morgue. How do you explain that?
Well, there are so many people who had been found that maimed
and
killed.
What about this case? You must know about this case, Dr. Shaaban. You've always stood up for women's rights.
I know. I refuse the accusation that it is the government or the country or the security people who are killing
these people. Who decapitated her and tied her arms, her hands, and her feet?
Well, I can show you 10 neighbors of my family in Homs who had been killed and maimed and who had been strangled by armed gangs. And this is why we need the world to stand with us in order to fight this kind of terrorism, because this is terrorism, whether it is on the streets of London or here.
Let's talk about what the government can do. Why has the president not stood up and said in any of his speeches, we're sorry about these cases where the security forces went far beyond what I expected, what I told them to do? Because there has been 103 deaths, according to Amnesty International, in detention, including, judging by the videos, grotesque mutilations.
I don't think any of that is verified at all. I mean, I don't think that's verified
that
at
none
all.
Of those.
The president went up and said that the security forces, even at the beginning, they were not carrying arms. That's how so many people of our policemen were killed, so many of our security people were killed. But what you need to do is to think of how to get the country out of this crisis. The problem is that the West calls everybody a protester and refuse to acknowledge that Syria is facing terrorist fundamentalist groups, whether they are on the streets of London or on the streets of Damascus. This is terrorism. And now it is here, tomorrow it could be somewhere else. So the Western pressure is only making things more difficult for us and for the Syrian people to handle the crisis in a proper way and to help solve the crisis and move forward in a peaceful march for democracy and for pluralism.
Well, we hope you'll allow us to travel to these cities to see for ourselves exactly what the situation is.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Dr. Shaaban, thank you very much there.
Thank you.
You heard from her this concern that the country could be sliding into a sectarian war. That is a concern being expressed on both sides. But in the current crisis, both sides are blaming the other for this impasse. And that's what it is now in Damascus, across this country, a stalemate and a dangerous one. That's all from us. From the studios of Syrian television, back to you in London.